What is going on, guys? Welcome to episode number 54 of our Cincinnati Bengals franchise. If you guys are not caught up to speed, we won the Super Bowl. Last episode, episode 53, was Super Bowl number 54, right? I kind of wish that this episode 54 would have been the Super Bowl. Super Bowl 54. But nonetheless, it didn't work out that way. We are now in free agency for 2020, heading into 2021. And there's a lot of big names in the market. And a lot of you guys were talking about trying to go after Julio Jones. We had some guys talking about possibly getting Ndamukong Suh. Vontaze Burfict didn't get a whole lot of love in the comment section to bring back. And I'm kind of there with you guys. I don't really feel like Vontaze is worthy of bringing back. I mean, we do have Malik Jefferson. I know he's 6 years younger and a 72 overall. So he's not showing the propensity to be a Vontaze Burfict type. But we've got some pretty good linebackers in Darren Lee. We've also got Tyrell Dodson backing up at middle linebacker and Bernardrick McKinney at middle linebacker as well. We got some good linebackers. I do think we need another one, but I'm not wanting to spend more money in bringing back Vontaze Burfict, 30 years old. So this is kind of a move that might be unpopular, but it's a move that I think is necessary to kind of keep the engines moving forward. Got to keep moving forward and get better. We got to get better. We got to get younger. We got to get better. Always. Every time. All the time. So let's go ahead and take a look and see some of the players here that I'm thinking about going after. And I actually have a couple offers up on the board. I will show you guys that before we talk about the quarterbacks. And looking here at my negotiations for the top 100, we're going after AJ Green. Going after AJ Green, we are currently offering him two seasons, about $7.25 million per year, with a $7.46 million signing bonus. Altogether, that's going to be a $21.9 million contract. He doesn't have any more bids on him currently. Now, a lot of people might think that this might not be a smart move. Well, he's going to finish out his career here in Cincinnati, hopefully. He is still an 87. 2 years from now, he'll be a 35-year-old player. Hopefully then, you know, AJ Green retires or he does something else or we move on from him, right? And then he ends up signing with another team for maybe a one-year deal for cheap, right? But we're going to try to soak up two more seasons out of AJ Green and get the most out of him that we can. John Ross is not a number one guy, right? Desmond Dallas is still an 80 overall. Martavis Bryant in that 81, 82 role. Our receiving core is stacked, right? And if you get AJ Green back here, you still have your true number one. You can still kind of groom Desmond Dallas to become that future number one. And then from that point, we'll see what happens, right? But as of right now, we need to bring AJ Green back. We've got the money to do it. Makes sense to do so. Brandon Brooks, a right guard, used to play for the Philadelphia Eagles. Now, we actually tried to get him in a trade. I never showed you guys that gameplay. But I tried to end up getting Brandon Brooks last season through a trade. But we ended up sticking with Lane Johnson. So we ended up making a trade for Lane Johnson. I wanted to go after Brandon Brooks. Didn't get it done. But at an 83 overall, we're only going to be paying him $7.76 million for one season. We're getting a 13 overall difference at the right guard position for less money. Right? I know that Caleb Johnson's with us for, well, that's over 3 years, but I think he's with us for another couple seasons. Maybe he's only with us for one more year. But getting Brandon Brooks in here is going to help the pass protection. It's going to help the run game for sure. And he's a guy that we need. He's a guy that we need. Simply put, we're above the Giants right now. We're above the Seahawks only by 1 point. We're going to see what happens. We're going to see what happens. I might have to adjust the offer here as it goes forward, but I think this is going to be good enough to get Brandon Brooks. I think it's going to be good enough to get AJ Green. Maybe AJ Green waits another week. We'll have to see how that's going to pan out. But there are a couple guys that I want to look at going forward here because we do need a little more depth in certain spots. And the other depth that we need is at quarterback. We need a backup quarterback to Tim Brady. Now, Andy Dalton's actually not asking for a whole lot of money to be the backup quarterback. But here's the deal. I don't really want any sort of competition for Tim Brady, honestly, for being the backup quarterback. I want somebody that's going to be, you know, a viable option, but I don't want to bring a guy in that's going to have direct competition to Tim Brady. We want to be good, but we don't want to be too good at the backup quarterback position, right? I know that Brady is durable enough to take the hits. I don't see him ever getting hurt. I know that's a really lofty prediction, but I don't see him becoming that guy that gets hurt over and over and over and over again, right? But there's a couple guys that have some starter experience, and I kind of want to bring in a guy like Sam Bradford, but he's asking for a lot of money, 10.8 total. I'm not really feeling it. You know, Trubisky over 3 years at $28 million. That's, you know, it's a decent offer. Jacoby Brissett, 23.6. He might be a guy that I might want to consider. Tannehill's not asking for a whole lot of money either at 9.3 over one season. Now, I could go after like a guy like DeShone Kizer, but everybody knows that DeShone Kizer is not too good. Trevor Siemian might be the smart pick here. Now, we might want to go after like A.J. McCarron. A.J. McCarron would be really cheap at $4 million there. Actually, everybody's asking for $405. And I think that you guys actually have a connection with A.J. McCarron. You guys want me to... If this was on the board, I'm pretty sure... I'm trying to read you guys and what you think that I should do. And I have a feeling that you guys watching this right now would say, go, pull the trigger, get A.J. McCarron in here. Everybody here likes him. Do it. Just do it. 6'3" quarterback, 220. Trevor Siemian, 6'3" quarterback, 220, age 29. McCarron's older. I mean, let's just do it, guys. Let's get A.J. McCarron back into a Bengals uniform. I was thinking about, like, Trevor Siemian. Like, he would make sense to be a backup quarterback. But, you know, hey, A.J. McCarron can serve as that guy as well. So we got 92 points on him for the top bid. I think that that's going to be good enough for McCarron to come on through here and put on that Bengals uniform yet again. Now, there was another guy that had a custom recruit. His name is David Ott in the subscriber. That's the name of the subscriber there, David Ott. And he wanted me to actually go after his custom guy, Jason Hall. And, you know, I can't do it. They're asking for way too much. He was drafted by the Texans. And let's go ahead and take a look at that trade screen right about now. All right, so I always like to get you guys involved in sort of the decision-making and be very transparent on what you're seeing on screen and the thought process that I have going forward with this stuff. So Deshaun Watson's actually signed. He's got five more seasons for the Texans. So there's really, unless like there's a career-ending injury or they somehow find a trade for Deshaun Watson, I don't see Jason Hall ever doing anything in a Texans uniform. He's actually got three more seasons under his contract. And even if we want to offer a trade for Jason Hall, something that makes sense. Now, a lot of you guys are probably going to like throw me under the bus here and be like, Gold, what the heck are you doing? But let's throw Sam Hubbard in, right? This seems like an even trade, right? They need an end, a speed rush type of guy that they're not even close to being interested, right? Well, what if we threw in Sam Hubbard and like a fifth round draft pick? Now, remember, this is actually their pick. Remember when we got that trade for Bernardrick McKinney? They gave us one of their draft picks, a fifth round. This is it. So let's see if we can give it back to them, right? So they're not interested in this offer, right? Orange. We got an orange. Now, what if we did our other fifth round pick? Would they be doing this? Would they want that? Okay, we got a little bit closer. We got a little bit closer. But honestly, in real life, that's a ton of things to give up for a backup quarterback, right? If we're being honest with ourselves, giving up a backup left end, a guy who's going to play, and a two fifth round draft picks that we could use to like build up our offensive line late and get younger, because we do have Lane Johnson, we do have Nate Solder, who are progressively starting to lose overall rating every year for a backup quarterback, right? Jason Hall is probably never going to be the guy to unthrow or usurp Tim Brady, right? So as of right now, we'll see how things shake out in the future. But as of right now, this trade is not something that I'm going to really consider. Now, I could remove both of these and add a fourth in there. And I don't think that they're going to take this either. So they're not going to take that, right? So I guess what I'm trying to say is that I feel bad because I really want to get you guys having your players on this team and really seeing how things go, but I can't sacrifice that. I can't sacrifice doing what's best for the team, for subscribers, right? I can't do it. So Jason Hall, you're going to sit there behind Deshaun Watson. You're going to fight the good fight, and maybe one day a trade does pop up for us that makes sense. But as of now, A.J. McCarron looks like he's going to be our backup quarterback. Also need to talk to you guys about the team salaries here and the projections of how many years are remaining on certain positions, right? We just signed Carl Lawson to a 5-year deal, and it was actually a 6-year deal, but 5 years left remaining as of 2021 going into this season here. And you guys will notice that at quarterback, we're good. If we sign A.J. McCarron, that 1-year deal, being that backup quarterback, I think that's gonna even this positional group out. Joe Mixon was signed to a long-term deal. Kemi Martin's got 3 years left. We got two guys down here, Douglas Clay out of Oregon, and then Ty Hill at running back, Mark Walton, third stringer. I think we're pretty much set at running back. We don't really need to do too much there. Ricky Ortiz at 1 season, John Ross at 3, Dallas at 3, Martavis Bryant with 2, Maryland at 2, which he's more of a practice squad guy. Tyler Boyd has 1 season left on contract. So it seems like, again, at wide receiver, we're gonna be fine. We don't really need to address that position other than getting a true number one, which would be AJ Green for 2 more seasons. So even then, we're still looking pretty good as far as depth goes. As far as tight end goes, though, we need to do something here at tight end. And I know that we're gonna be able to re-sign Tyler Croft and re-sign Uzomah during this season. So I don't think that drafting a guy makes a whole lot of sense yet. I know that we've got a couple more good seasons out of Croft left. There's really no reason to take a tight end right now. I know that these guys are kind of getting up there in age at 28, but you know, you don't want to waste a pick that you can possibly fix something else, right? We can definitely re-sign Tyler Croft to like a 3-year and then Uzomah to like a 2, kind of have that depth there. Left tackle, this is a position that we need to focus on. So Lane Johnson, I'm probably not going to re-sign. At 31 years old, he's got 1 more season left remaining, and it just goes downhill for old offensive linemen, you know. Lane Johnson's a really good left tackle, really good, but I can't bring myself to re-signing a guy that's going to be like 35 by the time that, you know, his re-sign is going to be up and good. It just doesn't make a whole lot of sense. Left guard, Bo Benshaw has been pretty solid at a 75. He's not a world beater type of offensive lineman, but he does get the job done. He's very scrappy. He helps in the run game. And we got him for 2 years. We've also got Taylor Posey, who's actually been pretty good. And if we look at his stats and his player card here, for being a rookie, I think he played pretty well. He didn't allow a sack. Now, guys, he actually played. He played a heck of a lot last season. Yeah, I mean, he did not allow a single sack. And if you guys remember, he actually came in for the injured Bo Benshaw, who was out for multiple weeks. So the fact that Posey didn't allow a sack, a 66 overall, only bodes well for his future. Billy Price, starting center, got 1 year left remaining for him at a 78. He's not really going anywhere in my mind. He's going to stay here. Caleb Johnson at a 70 overall, right guard. So he's making $9 million. And again, we just talked about it, how Brooks is going to, if we sign him, is going to come on in, be that starting right guard. Caleb Johnson, I mean, we're going to be paying a lot of money for a backup, but, you know, we got the money to spend, right? We got the money to spend. Right tackle, Nate Solder's down to a 69. You guys were not joking. When I made that trade, you guys were all over me about it, and I can see why, because you guys probably had a lot more experience with the game and how players either progress or regress, and you guys weren't joking. Nate Solder goes way down from when we traded for him, but luckily it worked out, because now we've only got 1 more season remaining with Nate Solder. He's going to be bye-bye after this year. So again, tackle is a position that we need to address for sure in this draft, for sure, whether it's a left tackle or a right tackle. We just need a tackle. Simply put, we need to address tackle and get young, and then we can figure it out from there. Left end, we've got Jordan Willis signed up for 3 more seasons. Hubbard, got one more year left of him. Kafusi out of BYU. You know, I'm watching some film out of Kafusi. He's really slow off the line. He's really slow off the line. So, I mean, hence why he's a 68, right? And he's 24 years old. So I don't project him to do anything with us other than being kind of a depth type of guy, maybe even on a practice squad. But, you know, left end's going to be fine for us. Right end's going to be fine for us for quite a long time. So our end spots are going to be locked up and pretty good. Defensive tackle, this is something that we need to address going into this offseason as well, whether that's by the draft or it's by free agency. But Jonathan Hankins, one more season left at 29 years old. I mean, you know what? He's actually kind of still young. You know, at 29, he can play for another 4 more years, right? I mean, Geno Atkins is 33 at a 79. You know, Geno Atkins is probably going to be bye-bye, in my opinion, as well. You can't really have a guy. I'm really a stickler for defensive ends and defensive linemen, actually. And for me, you got to be really good at defensive line. It's one of the most important parts of the game. And at a 79, and you know you're kind of old, you're gonna lose a step. So Geno Atkins, this might be his last season in a Bengals uniform. I know, not a lot of people are gonna like that, but it is what it is. But again, we do have to focus on defensive tackle. Deron Lee, I ended up moving him over from middle linebacker to left outside. Just to take over that spot at a 78, we have Devon Horn right there. We drafted that player at a 68, so he's not bad, but he's got some room to grow. We seem to be okay at the linebacker spot. Also have Tyrell Dodson out of Texas A&M, Bernardrick McKinney locked up for 3 more seasons. So, yeah, I mean we're looking pretty solid at linebacker. We could also, again, we could address this in free agency. Probably get another young guy. We could probably even sign Malik Jefferson, too. He's not going to be that expensive going forward into next season. And then we have cornerback position where we've got Hunter, a guy that we drafted and we really like, 74 overall. He's pretty dang good. We got Kendall Sheffield up to an 81 overall. 2 more seasons there for him. Troutman at a 71. Darquez Dennard. Actually, I think Darquez Dennard is, I think in real life, in the offseason, they were talking about Darquez Dennard. Is he even on the team anymore? I'm not sure. William Jackson locked up for 3 more seasons. So we're pretty solid here at corner as well. I'm not too concerned. Again, if there's a guy that can fill in, he can be that 75, be that 77. You know, that's going to help. That's always going to help. You can never have too many defensive backs in my mind. Jesse Bates, this is a big one. 82 overall player. Years remaining, this is his last year. So we do have to re-sign him this season. So I guess, All in all, going into this year, I want to make free agent moves. We got to hit really well in the draft, as always, but we got to have enough funds going into 2021 so that we can sign these guys back. I want to bring Jesse Bates back in season. I don't want him to go down to free agency in 2021. I want to be able to re-sign him, boom, like that. So got to consider these things. Got to make sure that we're around the $20 million range as we head into next season. And again, we got to have enough money to do so. And when we go forward, I want you guys to see something about our stadium. Our stadium also needs some renovations, and it's not looking too good. So the available funds that we have is really nice, and it's been the highest since we've had it in quite a while. And it looks really hot and it looks really sexy. And we're like, ooh, we could do things. But you want to be careful because you want to have money for Bates. You want to have money for Malik Jefferson, which is probably not going to be a problem. You're going to want to have money for Jonathan Hankins. And you're going to want to have money for probably not. I mean, we'll have to see. You're going to have money for Billy Price. So a lot of big names are coming off the boards at Tyler Croft. So I want to be careful on how we utilize our available funds here. And I don't want to go overboard because, again, we do need to take that into account. So I'm going to go ahead and I'm going to go simulate, and I will give you guys an update on where everybody went. Let's just go ahead actually and show you some cornerbacks. Some pretty solid players here, but you know, I'm thinking we can kind of wait on some of these players too, because like I said, I'm not really looking to give away Kendall Sheffield's job as the number two. I want a guy that's going to come in and be kind of that 77 overall and be that nickel, be that third guy. So we got a long way to go. Let's go ahead and simulate. All right, cool. So there we go, guys. We got Brandon Brooks. We got AJ McCarron. We got AJ Green. Sweet. And you know what? Our funds only took about $3 million away from us. Perfect. We're setting ourselves up here pretty, pretty good. Available cap room is now down to 25, which is solid. And I want to show you guys some of the league signings. So Julio Jones is going to the Giants. Ndamukong Suh re-signs with the Rams. Vontaze Burfict going to Dallas. Jason Kelce, the center, going to Miami. Eddie Jackson, the Raiders. David Njoku with Cam Newton going to go ahead and go with the Panthers. James White going to the Jets. Daquan Jones, Dolphins. Sean Williams. We did not bring Sean Williams back. And I think I talked about this a little bit in episode 53, the last episode, that Jaquan Johnson, in my mind, is ready to take over that strong safety position. And Sean Williams, at being 30 years old, like, he's solid. He's a decent player. But I think it's just time to move on. You know, he's 30. It's time to move on. Olivier Vernon going to the Pats at 30 years old. Larry Ogunjobi going to the Giants at 27 years old. Rashawn Melvin going to the Cardinals. Melvin Ingram, nice. Justin Coleman also going to the Cardinals. Gary Conley going to the Giants. Denzel Perryman going to the Giants. So the big winners in free agency thus far look to be like the Giants and the Cardinals. Andy Dalton signs with the Chargers. Wow. We'll have to go look and see what the starting quarterback situation is for LA. I think I called him San Diego again. Dietrich Wise Jr. going to the Giants. Samson Abukam going to the Seahawks. Jake Ryan going to the Dolphins. Jeremy Hill, Chargers. Yeah, so now we're down to like the 75. So Vance McDonald, Kenny Moore, Anthony Harris. Yeah, so I mean, pretty good players. Corey Littleton. Corey Littleton's actually a really good player. You know, he's not really rated that well out of 73. That's interesting. Leonard Skinner. Oh, that's great. This might not be a flashy selection, but Malik McDowell, 25 years old, 6'6", 299. He's a big boy. Out of Michigan State, 4 years pro. I know he's a run stopper. I mean, he seems like a pretty good player for us. 86 strength, block shedding is an 82, power move 78, tackle 81. He's going to end up being slotted in at the number 3 defensive tackle spot. That doesn't mean we can't draft another one, but Malik McDowell might be worth it here. So $5.5 million in the bonus. I think that might make some sense. You guys can see the available funds right there. It'd probably knock us down because this is going to be a four-year deal. Signing bonus is going to probably knock us down to about $33 million right there. Now we could, like I've always mentioned here, we could possibly select another linebacker, but I like to sign linebackers in the draft, honestly. Because when you start going after guys that are in the free agents, you know, there's a reason why they're letting linebackers go in the free agents. They can't play anymore, right? Or they're asking for too much money, or they can't play anymore. So I want to focus on linebacker in the draft. Now, if we wanted to go after a nickel corner, you might be able to get Josh Norman for cheap. Josh Norman would be a nice guy. Now, we did get Aqib Talib, and he helped us win a Super Bowl, right? Do we really think that a guy like Josh Norman is going to be okay with being a number 3 guy? He's going to have to be. He's going to be right behind Kendall Sheffield. He can still play. He's a scheme fit. He can still do his thing. Jason McCourty, I think he's a little bit cheaper. 374, 322. Joe Hayden is also a scheme fit. So we got, yeah, I mean, these guys are not too bad. Cordarrelle Tankersley is a little bit younger at 27. He's a 78, so we could actually lock him up for a little bit longer. Tremaine Johnson, older, but he's a 271. Yeah, so all these guys are, there's a lot of them. There's a lot of them. It all makes sense. But who do we like more? 6'1", Cordero Tankersley, or Jason McCourty at 34 years old? He's a zone guy. Tankersley's that man-to-man. As a nickel guy, you kind of got to be in the zone. You know what I mean? I'm thinking Jason McCourty might be worth it. All right, guys, so we did get Jason McCourty and Malik McDowell, and look at, it didn't even really hurt us that much in the available funds. So pretty sweet, right? Defense is looking pretty solid right now. We'll go ahead and look at some college players, and then we'll actually go ahead and see if there's any other move that we could possibly make. I don't think I want to make another one. I think we're pretty much set as far as the roster goes for free agency. We'll go address the needs in the draft a little bit later on. So Brandon Brooks, right guard, Price, Benshaw, Solder, and Lane Johnson. This is actually going to get flipped. So Nate Solder is going to be the right tackle. Johnson is going to be the left tackle. AJ Green, Martavis Bryant, Tyler Boyd, John Ross, Desmond Dallas. I like it. Tim Brady, AJ McCarron, McSorley, Mixon, Kemi Martin. Boom, baby. That offense is legit. It's an 81, but it's legit. Jaquan Johnson at the starting safety spot, the strong safety. We got Trey Weddle backing him up. Malik, McKinney, Dodson, Lee, Jesse Bates, Trey Weddle right there. Sheffield, Hunter, Jackson, Willis, Hubbard, Hankins, Malik McDowell right there. Geno Atkins, Carl Lawson. Whew, man, nasty. Darko's Dinar, and then there's Jason McCourty. So we're looking pretty good, guys. We're looking pretty good. I like it. The scheme fit, though, is not working. So it's at a 63% right now. So what are we going to do here? Can we fix it? A base 3-4 gets it to be about 77%. A 4-6. Ooh, I don't want to. That's, ugh, no. A base 4-3? A base 4-3? What was it before? Multiple 4-3? We need to go to a base 4-3. That's what we need. Yep. We need to get that scheme fit to fit our players that we have and make sure that the chemistry is working on all cylinders right there. So 81% scheme fit. Everything seems to be good right there. All right. Cool. So that's going to be that for the starting roster. Let's go ahead and get an update here for the free agents and see where the heck everybody has gone. Christian McCaffrey going to the Titans. Who else did we not cover? Desmond King going to the Texans. Roby Coleman going to the Giants. Giovanni Bernard, familiar face, going to the Jets. And let's see if there's anybody else here that didn't make the last one. Corey Coleman, former Brown, again with the Josh Gordon connection here with the Patriots. Charles Harris, Logan Ryan, Samaje Perine. I like Samaje Perine. If I'm the Detroit Lions, I'm trading for Samaje Perine this season. We need a guy that's going to be like that big grinder type of back, right? 5'11", 236, got to have it. Be a nice compliment to Kerryon Johnson. But this is Bengals. This is all Bengals. Josh Norman going to the Jets. Let's see. Boswell, Sam Bradford signs with the Steelers. Anybody else here? Not too much. All right, so I think that we're done. I think that we're done for free agent signings. I know that we have an option to go after Takaris McKinley. Campbell would be nice. Tariq Cohen would be... Could you imagine that? Tariq Cohen, Mixon, and Kemi Martin. It's amazing. But yeah, we just want to save some money, guys. We want to save some money because we're going to need to be able to sign those guys that we just talked about. Bates, Price, Hankins. They're all coming off the books, so we're going to be able to afford them. Next thing I wanted to go over before we go into scouting the college players is the stadium. If you guys have any insight on this, would you upgrade the stadium? It's going to cost us $15 million to renovate the parking, $15 million to renovate the team store. Here's the deal. If you upgrade something, it gets you that 24 rating. It's going to cost you more money than just to renovate it. So I don't know why you wouldn't just renovate it. You know what I mean? It doesn't make a whole lot of sense. Renovating the fan zone. You guys can see this, right? The levels, the ratings are terrible. Our facilities are awful right now. And you got to spend some money to make some money, right? Have to do it. Have to do it at some point. Got to take care of your stadium. All right, so what are we going to do here? Tight end. There's a couple guys that we were looking at. And honestly, there's not really a whole lot going on. Maybe we might want to look at R.L. Duckett or Samuel John. Mason Angerer, not really doing it for me. Second round projection. I mean, these guys right here might be fine. Brody Ferwerda, Casey Dalton might be pretty good as a vertical threat. But yeah, we need to focus on offensive line. This guy, got to stay away from him. Henry Person, you know, left tackle, doesn't look too good. Lucas Alexander would be a nice pick. Jesse Manley had a 5.5 in the combine there. Roderick Cyprian, not too bad in the fourth round. Kevin Holley out of Ohio. Ouch. Bradley Hammond might be pretty solid. So let's see what this guy's got to offer here. First and three cone, 20-yard shuffle. First, this guy might not be too bad of a pick out of Houston. He can move a little bit, kind of fits with what we want. Joe Mixon likes to get outside, so we need a guy that's going to get off the block and be able to run with him a little bit. Left guard, again, we're not really looking at left guard. Center, we need to back up center. You know, Billy Price needs some help there. Right guard, yeah, we got to focus on right guard a little bit. I know. Not a whole lot here, but you got to make do with what you can. Leviticus might be not bad of a pick. I know that was a custom recruit. B in the run block, B in the pass block, B in the finesse. He was first in the three cone, first in the 20. Here's a guy that probably wouldn't play the first season, right? You draft him in the first round, and then he wouldn't play. But it's not like we're picking very high, right? We're last. We're picking number 30, 31, 32. I don't even remember how many teams are in the NFL. Okay, Reggie Garner. There are no right tackles, guys. There are no right tackles except for Eric Skelton out of Arizona State. Another agile tackle here. 4.7. He ran a 4.7. How heavy is he? 315? That's a big dude running a 4.7. That might be our guy. Second round. Oof. He's moving, boys. He's moving. Let's look at, we don't need to really focus on ends. We really don't. Defensive tackle, we do need to focus on. Probably some guys that are kind of in the mid rounds here. Boston College, TJ Hopkins, C plus block shedding, C tackle. You don't want that. Malcolm Mays, I'm sorry, buddy, but you know we can't really consider you at this point. Francis Blair might not be too bad of a pick. I saw that C plus pursuit and decided to go a little bit further. He had a 5.9 in the combine. Bench press, fourth. He was fourth with 35 reps. So he's a strong guy. Very strong guy. So with free agency having been completed, we are now going into the 2021 NFL Draft. And as the Jets make their pick, guys, I just want to say thanks for hanging in there with me. This is a long episode. I realize that, but there's a lot of things to cover. And I always like to be transparent with you guys on why the decisions are being made and what decisions are being made and what the rationale is, really, because there's a lot of people that comment in the comment section saying, hey, Gold, why'd you do this? Why'd you do that? Why didn't you do this? So I always like to make sure I'm covering all my bases and letting you guys know what's up and where I stand. So if you actually hear my dog, he's in the background here. So I'm going to try to edit that out, but it's no guarantee. So, all right, so the Jets are taking Jordan Quarles, the cornerback from Tennessee. Now the Colts are going to take the defensive tackle Jason Brennan out of Auburn. And I'm actually just going to go ahead and skip right to the next user pick because really going to this next pick is probably going to be boring for you guys. And I'll actually go over the draft class and where everybody went as far as the draft results go after it's done and concluded. So here we go. All right, guys, so Bengals are on the clock. I've already looked at the picks to acquire if we end up trying to trade it away, and there's just nothing there. So we're going to go ahead and make our selection here, and as you guys will notice, some of your players are still up on the board. Lucien Laurent, Daryl Poties, Wembley Smith, the fourth is still up there. Let's see, who else was up here? I know Tanner Sharp was here. He's no longer there. Middle linebacker. Levi Craig actually went to the Raiders. Pierce Hinton, Sonata, you guys are still available. Christian Squishy still there. And Paul Wilkerson, you are not there. So you have been picked by somebody, and we'll find out who that is a little bit later on. All right, guys, so taking a look and seeing who is available here, there's not a whole lot that we can possibly do. I mean, this would be the guy that we would probably end up taking is Keldrick Swilling. He would fit that outside linebacker need perfectly. He'd actually start ahead of Malik Jefferson, I'm assuming. I'm assuming he's not going to be a bust. With a 7.3 grade in the combine, yeah, he ran a 4.8. I know that's really slow for a linebacker, but everything else is pretty darn good. He's 6'2", 248. So he's a big body linebacker that's going to be able to get in there, get dirty, and stop the run. So I value that in the outside linebacker spot. I know Malik Jefferson's kind of that run stopper mold as well. So yeah, so it would be good to have consistency of the same player type out there at that outside linebacker spot. Samuel Jean, a second round tight end. I can't see myself taking a project tight end right now like that, and especially in the first round. He's got a C in the catching. It's not good enough for me, man. Gavin Pompey had a 6 in the combine grade. I can't see myself taking a wide receiver right now in the first. Eric Skelton might be the guy. Might be a good pick. At this point, you know, we're technically already in the second round. You know, round 1, pick 32. That's how it is. Sean Frampton, interesting pick. But, I mean, look at where we're at, though, guys. Like, this guy would be a great pick. Actually, look at the athletic ability right there. 6'4", 311. I don't know if he would start right away. That's the biggest thing for me. Skelton, though, that's the other thing. At a 6th grade, is he going to be able to start over Nate Solder? Is he going to be better than Nate Solder right off the bat? I would assume he is because he's a 69 right now. That's Nate Solder. But when you draft a right tackle or when you draft an offensive lineman, you want him to start like early. If it's in the first round, you want that guy to start. And seeing as how we're paying Nate Solder a crap ton of money and we're paying Lane Johnson a crap ton of money, it doesn't really make a whole lot of sense to draft a tackle just to sit him behind the veteran until they retire, until they leave, right? And you can't just give the rookie the job over a guy that you're paying like $10 million to, right? It just doesn't really work out that way. In reality, in real life, it doesn't work that way. So Skelton would be the obvious pick here, but to keep myself in check, I can't see myself doing it. Going down here a little bit further, I mean, now we're starting to get into the third round, and it doesn't look like there's not a lot there. So we're kind of in a sticky situation here, and I think the pick that we're going to have to do is taking this guy, Keldrick Swilling. It just makes the most sense. We have a need at outside linebacker. Other positions, we don't have an immediate need like that other than offensive line. But even then, like I said, you want a guy to start if you're taking an offensive lineman there. And yeah, I know that right tackle would. I know that Skelton would start over Solder, but in the situation that we're in, we're paying a lot of money to Nate Solder, so it just doesn't make sense. So Keldrick Swilling will be the pick, and let's see what he grades out to be. Nice. Okay, so he's a 78 overall outside linebacker. He's 22, 6'2", and again, he's just going to be that run stopper type of player. The speed rush, you can see it, 9 overall points lower. Pass coverage, 9 overall points lower. So we need to work with him a little bit to kind of round out his game, but I like what he's going to be able to do for us in the run defense. So drafted him at number 32. He is ranked number 16. It was a really good pick. I like it. All right, so as we see, Gavin Pompey getting taken just before us in the second round by the LA Rams at pick 31. Our pick is coming up here, and let's see who's on the board again. Oh, my God. Nobody needs a quarterback? Like, what is happening here? Oh my God. Darryl Poteis is still available. You know what? We might just take Lorenz or Poteis just to trade him away at this point. If there's nothing available here, that might be the selection. Casey Dalton, the tight end. You know, we need a tight end. He ran as fast as TJ Hockenson. I know everybody's talking about Hockenson and for the 2018 draft. He's pretty good tight end, in my opinion. Early third round. Technically, we're already there. We're already in the early third round. He's 6'5", 261. But here's the thing. Do we want another redheaded Dalton on the Cincinnati Bengals? I'm going to pass. I'm going to hard pass. Lucas Alexander is still here. Left tackle, 5.7 graded out. He seems like he's a pretty decent prospect. The bench press kind of leaves a little bit to be desired there at 29, but he's kind of in the middle. They say he's agile, but the three cone and the 20-yard would suggest otherwise. But the vertical and the broad jump were pretty solid too, so that means he's got some pretty good acceleration, I would assume. 40-yard dash to 4.9, so he's almost running as fast and as quick as a tight end, namely this one. Ran a 4.6. I know that's 0.3 seconds quicker, but nonetheless, it's still pretty dang good. So yeah, I mean, he's pretty agile. We need to work with him a little bit, though, as far as the agility goes. I mean, he's got some acceleration to get off the line. He's 6'7", 320. He'd be our left tackle of the future. Honestly, that might be the smart pick. Looking a little bit further down, I think we can probably get this guy, Brady Ferwerda, the tight end, a little bit later. Piscotty would be a nice pick. But again, you know, we don't really need a running back right now. Kay Reeves, left out. We already drafted a left out. Devin Minard. Justice Walters seems like he's pretty good. Michael Payne. Ooh, Michael Payne. Look at that. Ooh, free safety. Very athletic. But we also have Jesse Bates and Trey Weddle at free safety, so it doesn't seem to be a position that we need. Left tackle, we can still probably get a little bit later. But I'm kind of thinking that, ooh, look at this guy, Oscar Martinez. Nice. We could pretty much get two offensive linemen here. Right now, oh my God, look at this guy, Garrett Wong. Vertical threat out of Florida, 4.67, he was the fastest. He is athletically gifted. We just got to work on him a little bit. Might be a good pick, a backup. Ahmad Newman. Interesting grades here for a left guard. 6'6", 339. We can move him to right. Oh my God, guys, look at this. First in broad. First in three cone. Second in 20 yard. I would be hard-pressed to not take him in the third round, guys, if he's there. Let's just do this. Let's see what we got here. So he's a 75. So we actually did a good job, right? He's a quick progression. Ranked 61 in True Talent. We drafted him at 64. So we weren't really that far off with him. Ooh, those are pretty solid numbers too. 86 run block finesse, 82 strength, 83 block. Yeah, that's pretty good. Acceleration's 70. I think we did a pretty good pick right there. Lucas Alexander, welcome to Bengal stripes. So guys, I actually want to move up in this draft just a little bit because I feel like there's positions that we need to focus on and there's guys late that I like that I think can help us in the future. So I'm going to offer this trade to the Vikings just to see if they take it. You know, I just want to see if they'll bite. We're going to try to get their round 3 pick 78 for Malik Jefferson. They do need a right outside linebacker. Let's go ahead and offer this trade. They're not interested in it, so that sucks because I really wanted to see if they would do it. Another team that's needing a right outside would be the Detroit Lions. So they actually have round 3, pick 79. So let's see if they would do it. I feel like the Lions would be suckers and do it. So they did it. So Malik Jefferson is a Detroit Lion, which is okay, which is fine. I think that that's good. They need a guy like that. Malik Jefferson was good for us, but, you know, we got our left outside linebacker, right? And he can move out to right, or Deron Lee can move out to right. I think were pretty good at the linebacker spot. You know, with Swilling, he was probably going to play over top of Jefferson anyway, being a 78 and Jefferson being a 72. So that sets us up in a pretty good spot here in the third round. We have two third round picks now, and now we're right in the middle and at the end. So let's go ahead and see. I'm actually going to do this now, advance the next pick over and over and see what's available to us. So Lucien Laurent finally gets taken in the third round by the Indianapolis Colts, and Mason Thigpen going to the Dolphins. Lorenzo Miles right outside going to the Saints. Omame going to the Raiders. Otha Shepherd, left guard. Reed Longwell. So we're starting to get a little bit closer. Anthony Fernandez, Corey Swanson. Dextrell Avant going to the 49ers. Tremel Gritton going to the Seahawks. Darrell Potiz going to the Denver Broncos. So just a few picks ahead of us, he goes away. So DeMarcus Kirkendall. And then the Vikings taking Nathan Kern, the next quarterback up on the board. So now here is our pick. This is awesome. This is actually going to pan out really well for us because that's going to set us up to make a really good selection here. So we've got our left tackle. We got our left outside linebacker. Now we need to focus on a position of need. We could possibly take Kay Reeves right here to, again, kind of fill that left outside linebacker spot or that right outside linebacker, whichever, just kind of like that backup type of role. But we could possibly even take him late in the third. A guy that I'm really looking at here would probably be Garrett Wong. Thinking about Garrett Wong right here. I know it's really weird, right? He's projected as a late fourth. But when we're really looking at it, is there really anybody else available? I know that left guard was available. Ahmad Newman had a sixth. I mean, look at the stats, man. He's 6'6". That's hard to pass up. So let's go ahead and take this guy, Ahmad Newman. I mean, look at this, guys. The top skills, they're all green. They're all in the Bs, and then the combine reports. I mean, he was the number one combine-graded left guard in four of these six categories. So I say let's do it. Let's see what happens. Oh, yeah. Let's go. Yeah, 76. Holy crap. He was ranked, Ahmad is ranked 38 in true talent, and he drafted him at 79. Strength is a 90. Lead block, 84. Dang. So, I mean, he's already better than Bo Benshaw. But that's okay. That's all right, because Benshaw's going to start, and then when we get Brooks gone after this season because he's a rental, he's only signed for 1 year, then it's the Ahmad Newman show. Let's advance Roland Owens. Let's advance Lawrence Iloka. Okay, so with round number three, pick 32, guys, we've got a few choices to make here as well. So Piscotty's still on the board. Ferwerda's still on the board. Kay Reeves is still here. You know, we've got our tackle of the future. We got our guard of the future. So I think we did a pretty good job with our offensive line this draft. There's not really the man-to-man right there for Sonata. He's a fifth rounder, though, so we might be able to wait. I don't want to wait on a tight end anymore. And I know that of these tight ends, there's a few guys that we could consider. But, you know, Garrett Wong graded higher than any of them did. But Garrett Wong was way more athletic. I think let's just do it. Let's do it because I don't like any of these guys. I think they're kind of misleading. And everybody else, I feel like we might be able to wait out. Like, look at this, guys. We might even be able to take Hammond and McMarvin a little bit later. We could technically, in this draft, we could solve left tackle, right guard, and right tackle in a matter of two rounds. So I say let's take the tight end just in case we lose Croft or we lose Uzoma. I mean, who knows? Garrett Wong might even be better than those guys down the stretch. So let's go ahead and draft him. So it was a good pick. He's ranked number 69 in true talent. We got him at 96. Solid. He is a scheme fit, so he's going to progress nicely. even though he's in normal progression, I still think that that's a pretty solid pick. Let's go ahead and let's get a backup for Jaquan Johnson, because I do like what he's been able to do at the sub linebacker position. And if he's down there, we're going to need somebody to play strong safety. So might as well get this guy here. Justice Walters had a 6'5 in the combine. Then again, so did Brian Turner in run support. But this guy's more of a zone type of player. So let's see what he had to offer here. 4'6, which isn't bad for a safety. Can come down. I mean, he's strong. Can get off the blocks. Broad jump, vertical jump. So yeah, he's definitely really good in the zone. Can get back in that deep coverage. Brian Turner's pretty good himself too. He had a 4-5. That's a 6th-round player though. I'd say let's go with Justice Walters. He's the best player. Strong safety up on the board. Let's see what we got here. So it says we reached. He does have quick progression, so he's going to be another project type of player. But we didn't reach too badly. Didn't reach too badly. He's ranked 138. We got him at 128, right? So it's not too bad. 81 in zone, 83 speed. So this is speed that's going to kind of hurt him. But, you know, we can work on him a little bit. So, guys, with our 5th-round pick, I'm actually kind of going a little bit back and forth here. And I know it's kind of been a wild ride, but I can't help myself. I got to draft this dude. Mike Hollenbeck, a slot receiver out of Auburn, 5'9", 175. Ran a 4.4. He's pretty quick for the slot. I kind of have to do it this late. I mean, I know there's better receivers up here. Like, this guy graded out really well. Daryl Byrd had a 6'6", 6'7" for Patrick Trejo. And I know John Ross is kind of fitting that. He's a deep threat type of receiver, but I know he's kind of fits that mold of being a slot guy. It's tough. It's tough for me. I'm just going to do it. I like this guy, Mike Hollenbeck, and he turns out to be pretty solid. A quick progression rate, 73 overall. 109 is where he was ranked. Drafted him at 160, and he's got 92 speed. So if you think that John Ross torches the defenses in this game on drag routes, what do you think Mike Hollenbeck is going to do for us in packages that we're going to get him involved in? So short route is an 88. He's not going to be a deep route type of guy. He's going to really do some wonders for John Ross, Martavis Bryant, Desmond Dallas, AJ Green. I think he's gonna do some good things for this offense. So I think that's a really good bargain type of pick here in the 5th round. So welcome, Mike. So we got Keldrick Swilling, a 78 overall left outside linebacker. Lucas Alexander, a 75 left tackle. Ahmad Newman, a 76 left guard. Garrett Wong, a 74 tight end. Justice Walters to back up Jaquan Johnson at 72. Termell Bobo, backup center at 71. 73, Mike Hollenbeck, Lucky Epstein, and Dimitri Belton. So Belton's actually a 64. So he's definitely going to be a practice squad type of player. Let's go ahead and just skim through real quick on the rest of the teams and see if any one of your guys got taken. So I don't see anybody here other than Manny Darvish for the Bills. The Broncos. Daryl Poties. He's an 82. We should have taken him. We should have taken him, and then we should have been able to move him. Sonata is actually 74 overall. And I think at this point, guys, I'm just going to go ahead and scroll through and actually just kind of not talk. Okay? I'm just going to let you guys see it, visualize it, and then go from there. So leave a like if you like this thing, guys. I hope you enjoyed watching the draft. This one hurt. Craig McMarvin's a 76. Ooh, that hurts. Pierce Hinton, a 72. I thought we did good. I thought we did really well. I think that there were some picks that we possibly could have done a little bit better on, but that's always going to happen in the NFL draft. But leave a comment below. Let me know what you guys thought on the draft. Really wish we could have gotten Paul Wilkerson, but he just did not fall right down to us. So that kind of hurt. Haha, get it? Hurt. Yeah, okay. The Colts taking Skelton. He's 75. Lucian Durant, 80. Dishman's actually 74, so we didn't really do that bad. But yeah, so I'll see you guys in the next episode, which is actually going to be a simulation of the preseason, and we're going to get right into week number one and week number two gameplay next Sunday. So I'll see you guys in the next one. As always, hoo day and peace.